Hello, I'm welcome to episode number 496 of the YouTube 2020 Challenge Run. This is going to be Raw for week 3 of March 2024. It's here, we are in the Staples Center in Los Angeles for tonight's show, which will feature a big main event with WrestleMania implications, because we, as it currently stands, the WWE Women's Championship match at WrestleMania will be Becky Lynch defending against Charlotte Flair. But Bayley and Sasha Banks must coexist against Becky and Charlotte, who also must coexist in tonight's main event. A double can they coexist whammy, but if Becky and Charlotte lose and Sasha and Bayley win, that match at WrestleMania will become a fatal four-way. Plus, Gold Dust is back in action. He's putting on the paint one more time in LA to take on Gunther of Imperium, the man who'll face his brother for the WWE Championship at WrestleMania, and R-Truth takes on Pretty Deadly, with the winning team challenging Logan Paul and KSI for the Raw Tag Team Championships at WrestleMania. But it seemed R-Truth's partner, who he picked as Otis last week, who's, you know, got a pass of Pretty Deadly, was laid out when he's not here tonight, so we don't know who Truth's going to find to replace him. But without any more further ado, I guess, let's jump straight into tonight's show. We start with Edge. And we start with Edge. He comes to the ring, he's got like a sack. Like a big sack. Pause. A bag on his back that he's carrying stuff in. He takes a seat on a chair in the ring. He says, "Christian, in 2 weeks' time at WrestleMania, I'm, for the second time in my career, going to have the opportunity to compete in my last match. Also at WrestleMania, because it was 11... No, it wasn't 11. It was 11 when he came back. 13 years ago that I had my last match at WrestleMania the first time round, and this time I get to end my career on my terms. And I'm sure you can all see that at WrestleMania this year, I get to end my career against my dream opponent in my final match. My best friend of 40 years, Christian. Obviously, the circumstances around this match are not exactly how young Adam and Jay had imagined them back in 1990. You know, when we were at the Sky Dome watching Hulk Hogan and the Ultimate Warrior throw it down, and we said one day that'll be us. This isn't exactly what we had in mind. But it's what we're in store for at WrestleMania, and trust me, if you're a fan of Edge, you're a fan of the current Edge, but you weren't so much, maybe you're too young, because, God, we're all getting old now. Maybe you were too young to have experienced the Rated R Superstar in his prime. And you see that my match with Christian Cage is going to be no holds barred at WrestleMania. I called him Christian Cage, no Cage. My match with Christian is going to be no holds barred at WrestleMania. And you think, yeah, but what's Edge really willing to do? Well, I'll show you. And like he points up to the Titantron, and we get like a montage of Edge WrestleMania moments. You know, the spear onto Jeff Hardy. You know, the spear through a flaming table. That's about it, actually. Probably the concerto to Randy Orton in the WrestleMania match in the PC. And yeah, I can't think of anything else really particularly violent that Edge can show off, but I'm sure he's done other stuff. Just clips of him spearing people. Spearing Chris Jericho through a barricade. He did do that, so that could be on there. Trying to brush up on my Edge lore. But yeah, a highlight package of all of the extreme Edge WrestleMania moments. And then he goes into his bag and he starts pulling out weapons. And she goes, "Let's take a little preview of WrestleMania, shall we?" There's like a bag of thumbtacks. I see. He just plops the thumbtacks on the floor. He's got like a barbed wire baseball bat. He's got Spike. You know, we're going to bring Spike in because, you know, him winning a title by hitting Christian in the balls with a spike is funny. So we're going to bring Spike in. And yeah, he's going to go, "Yes, Christian, this is what you're in store for. You're in store for, you know, 50-year-old Adam, who's back here for one last ride in the spotlight to end the career the way he wanted it to. You're stepping into the ring at WrestleMania with a man you've never stepped into the ring with before. Because sure, me and you have had a lot of matches together. We've dreamed of matches together, but you've never faced the Rated R Superstar and seeing what that's like. But at WrestleMania, Jay, you're about to find out." He just gets up and leaves, taking all his weapons with him. And they get a quick backstage segment. Becky's in her locker room, you know, get putting her jacket on, ready for the main event. doing warm ups over, and Charlotte walks in, and Becky, of course, is immediately on the defense as soon as Charlotte walks in. She goes, "Relax, relax. For the first time in my life, I'm not here to belittle you or beat you up or dress you down or any of that, Becky. I'm here to, you know, we have to go over a plan for tonight." Becky goes, "Don't need to. I know what I'm doing. You stick to my plan and we'll get it done." She goes, "See, this is typical Becky, you see, thinking that your plan is just going to be so much better. But yes, Becky, listen to this. You may be the women's world champion, but you are the singles world champion. You're not a tag team. Okay, I've been tag team champion. You've never been tag team champion. So actually, I think in this tag team main event, I actually know more about what's going to go down than you do. And Sasha and Bayley, you know, even though they're at each other's throats right now because their relationship is about as rocky as ours, they have to coexist because they have to win tonight to get into this WrestleMania main event. And Bex, the more women in this WrestleMania main event, the harder it is for you to walk out women's champion." She sort of looks down at the belt, looks back at Charlotte and goes, 1, 2, 3, 6, 10 opponents. It doesn't matter how many opponents I'd face, Charlotte, because I'd put them all down one by one by one. But tonight, it's not about protecting this WrestleMania main event that I can win regardless of who I'm up against. It's about sending a message that I am the man and I run this division. And she storms out. Tata goes, "Great, see you tonight, bestie." 89, that's pretty good. I think the Big E match got in the 90s last week, so you know it's a step down from that, I guess, but Kofi's a little bit washed. Not in real life, specifically in the game, I believe. He's actually not declining. Okay, that's weird. He's just not very over for some reason. Like, he had his incredible run. Like, if you remember that, like, in 2021 when he was the Intercontinental Champion, he was putting on fucking absolute bangers. He had the random best match of the save at that point with John Morrison on Raw. Like, for some reason, he's just not that anymore. Like, no, his stats clearly haven't declined. Just, yeah. He gets a 78 and Drew gets a 94, but yes, Drew does win. He defeats the second member of the New Day in back-to-back weeks. 89 waiting for the match. After the match, Drew goes to deliver the beatdown even more on Kofi. Finally, Xavier Woods shows his face. He rushes the ring. He takes the fight to Drew McIntyre and he sends him to the outside. He goes, "Hey, Drew, is this the message you want to send, huh? No, attacking E, attacking Kofi, what, over a guy that you claim isn't good enough to get the job done against you? Huh? Because I see a guy who sure looks scared of a guy that he claims could never beat him 9 a million years. So, Drew, if this is the game you want to play, and you think I'm so beneath you, and I'm so nowhere near your level..." And he looks up at WrestleMania sign, he points to the sign, he's like, "Well, why don't you prove it?" And Drew goes, "Fine, your funeral. You really need to lose yet again, Woods. You think this is going to be your big breakout moment at WrestleMania? You think this is going to be the moment that cements you as the guy here on Raw? You've stepped into the lion's den. Because Drew McIntyre at WrestleMania is a different animal." But yes, there we go. The official announcement against Xavier Woods and Drew McIntyre once again at WrestleMania. I'm going to get a quick segment. Gold Dust is backstage. He's putting his face paint on in his locker room. Cody walks in. Goes, "Hey, Dustin. Goes, you know, here in LA again. Go get repping Gold Dust one more time." And he goes, "I was feeling, you know, going out there as myself. But tonight, I feel the lights. I feel the Los Angeles blight lights on me. Just like you are going to feel the bright lights on you at WrestleMania when you defeat Gunther and retain that WWE Championship tonight. I'm going to make that job easier for you because Imperium and Gunther, they're going to know what it feels like to taste the pain of gold." So yeah, Gold Dust in full Gold Dust gear, set for Gunther later on tonight. Then get a quick backstage segment. Dominic's warming up. And then Grayson Waller walks up and goes, "Hey, Dirty Dom, how you doing, lad? That's my best friend, Dirty Dom, right there." And he goes, "Hey, you know, I called you over here because, you know, I finally have my singles match against that Orange Cassidy guy. And I know I can beat his ass, especially if he's going to half-ass it like he always does. But I just thought I'd make sure that you're in my corner tonight. Was like, are you joking, lad? Of course I'll be out there, Dirty Dom. You're my best friend in the entire world. There's nobody I like more than you on this entire roster, lad. Then his phone beeps. He goes, you gonna take that? And while I look at his phone, he's like, ah, it's Aaliyah. It's like, oh, well, she won. It's like, she's got a match tonight against Kairi Sane, you see? And she's struggling to get in her gear right now. He sort of looks at Dominic. And Dom's like, well, are you gonna go? And while I laugh, he goes, are you joking? Of course I am, like, I couldn't miss this for the world. Hey, I'm sure you'll do great against Orange Cassidy, though. I love it. I'm sure you'll knock that guy back on his ass. Then Waller leaves, and Dom's like, okay, well, guess I'm going alone. Doesn't end well for Dom. Orange Cassidy defeats Dominic Mysterio in 14:32, beach break. 77 for Dominic, 66 for Orange. Him and Beatrice are an awkward pairing, but again, I may change it, but that also is kind of funny and kind of the point of the angle. So, you know, I may leave it. But yes, Orange Cassidy picks up the win over Dominic Mysterio. After the match, Dirty Dom, he's angry. He gets to his feet. He jumps Orange Cassidy. He starts beating him down. He drop kicks him onto the second rope. He's going to hit a 619 Orange Cassidy. He bounces off the rope, and as he runs back, he's met with an RKO. Randy Orton drops Dirty Dom with an RKO. And then Randy Orton's up, you know, he's going wild after he hits the RKO out of nowhere. And he turns around to him and he's face to face with Orange Cassidy. And we get Randy Orton Orange Cassidy face off. And then he does the shin kicks to Randy. Randy's over, so looks down awkwardly. Just shrugs his shoulders and just walks off. And Orange is just there, you know, giving a thumbs up to Randy as he leaves. We get a quick interview. Zoe Stark is here with Kathy Kelly. She says, Zoe, you know, you're here with a bittersweet, you know, interview here. You requested this time. What's up? And she's like, well, Kathy, I mean, of course I'm going to start with the bad news. You know, since I came to Raw alongside Sol Ruca, we've been looking to prove ourselves as the fastest rising tag team. And we've been looking to, you know, perhaps make our way to WrestleMania. You know, there's a battle royal going on. Maybe even a tag team championship match. But Sol has gone down with a hernia injury, and she's unfortunately going to miss WrestleMania, which means for the next month or so, I'm going to be flying solo here on Raw. So I guess best wishes to Sol, and we hope you be back soon. But I'm not going to stop trying to prove myself because my tag team partner's not here. I'm going to prove myself as a single star. I'm going to step up to the names on this roster, you know, the Becky Lynch's, the Charlotte Flair's, the Baileys, the Sashas, the Jade Cargills, the Rhea Ripley's. And she says Rhea Ripley's name. He sort of walked past and just stops and looks and goes, was that my name coming out of your mouth? She's like, yeah, it was. And what about it? Rhea goes, good. I hear your little friends out. I dare you to try me. So he goes, okay, well, fine. How about tonight? Rhea just laughs and goes, you're on. And she walks off. We then cut to Carmelo Hayes in the barbershop. You know, last week he and Trick had that split screen interview segment. And then Melo, he said, goes, you know, guess what I told Trick last week? He goes, he's going, hey, Melo, next time you come to Raw, I'm going to beat your ass, you know. First of all, he could never beat my ass, right, guys? Because I'm him, Trick ain't him. And I dare him to come and find me. And I was like, oh, I ain't gonna be there, Trick. You know, I got better things to do in Los Angeles than spend time with Trick Williams and those WWE fans, you feel me? And then we get a split camera shot. We just see Trick Williams, like, walking down the street. Like, it's a first-person view of Trick just walking down the street. Then we cut back to Melo. He's, like, laughing up at the people in the barber. He goes, hey, you know, gotta catch the cut, you know. This could be my WrestleMania haircut. This could be the WrestleMania haircut I whip Trick's ass with. Okay, and prove once and for all that I am him. Let me cut back to the Trick angle. And he's at the front door of the barbershop. And then, like, we cut back to Melo. Like, we see he's noticed Trick standing out front. He goes, hey, get him away from here. Get him away from here. Trick busts the door open. And then he jumps Carmelo Hayes, who's in the barber's chair. And we get a barbershop fight. Not quite like the Rockers, because, you know, it's an actual barbershop and not a talk show segment. But they brawl around, he throws them against the wall. Trick probably beats up a couple of the other people in there.
Maybe that he uses like the fucking all the hair equipment, uses the razor and shit to try and get him. And then in the end, he throws Carmelo Hayes through the window, and Carmelo lands on the floor on the outside before he scurries away. And Trish's like, "Yeah, you better run, your bitch ass, Melo, because there ain't gonna be no running from Tricky Willy at WrestleMania. I'll find you wherever the hell you are, and I'll beat your ass." Yeah, fun segment. We then cut back to Goldust and Gorilla after that. And Cody walks out to me and goes, "Hey, Dustin, how you doing?" He goes, big night. Gonna stick it to Gunther for you. And he goes, "Hey, I just noticed, Dustin. I know you said you wanted to do this. You wanted to bring Goldust back, run back the hands of time tonight. But Gunther's gonna have Ludwig. He's gonna have Giovanni out there with him. So I'm gonna be by your side tonight. And if they try and do any funny business, I'll knock them dead." Then Goldust music hits, and out he goes for a match with the Ring General, which only gets a 70 rating, obviously, because of the way it's booked. Gunther gets into the ring with Goldust, and him and Goldust have a little face-to-face. Gunther, like, shoves him away, like, disrespecting Goldust, the legend. And then Goldust slaps the fuck out of Gunther. And Gunnar, of course, doesn't like this. He boots Goldust in the face. And then what we proceed to get is murder. He chops the fuck out of Goldust. He, like, unzips Goldust's bodysuit. Chops his bare chest and shit like that. Dustin's just getting beaten up. He hits a powerbomb on Dustin. Gets a one. And then he, like, pulls Dustin's shoulder up. And he just continues to, like, unload powerbombs on Dustin. To an uncomfortable degree. Cody's at ringside, and he's just watching this all. And Gunnar's like hitting powerbomb. He's hitting lariats. He's hitting chops. He's hitting all your Gunnar greatest hits. And he's not even pinning this man. And then at the end, he goes to pick Goldust up for one more, like, finisher. And then Goldust just collapses to the floor. Gunnar just laughs at him on the floor. And then Cody throws in the towel. And he can't bear to stand anymore. He throws in the towel, the match is over, Gunther wins by, I guess, forfeit, is what we call that. But that's apparently not a finish in the game. So, like, there was stoppage, I believe. As a matter of fact, I put that, but it still says pinfall. Oh, because I put pinfall as well. Okay, duh, that's my bad. Yeah, but yeah, it is a stoppage. And Cody gets into the ring, he's cradling Dustin in his hands. And then Gunther's just standing over him. You know, the medics and the doctors are coming out with stretchers to take care of Dustin. Ludwig and Giovanni are by Gunther's side, and he's just glaring down at Cody. Cody's looking up at Gunther with Dustin out cold in his hands. It is the Rocky Drago Apollo shot, basically. Very appropriate with WrestleMania in Philly. You know? So, it is effectively that shot, except Dustin isn't actually dead. So, yeah. But Gunther has just destroyed Goldust here tonight in Los Angeles. Speaking of Cody and Rocky, here's the mania ad of Cody running through the streets and up the stairs. You know, the Rocky 2 run spot. Very Rocky-coded WrestleMania this year, especially for my American nightmare. We then cut back from, like, imagine that would be, like, when we cut ads. And then we come back from ads and Goldust's on a stretcher, getting carried away. Cody's there. He goes, I'm going to come with him. And they're like, no, you can't get in the ambulance, you can't. And then he watches the ambulance drive off. He's looking pissed off and just, like, he's holding back tears because he's Cody Rhodes, you know, he's very dramatic. He turns around and Ludwig and Giovanni Vinci are waiting there for him. He goes, "That, my friend, is what happens when a Rhodes gets on the wrong side of the Ring General. And that, Cody Rhodes, is what awaits you in just 20 nights at WrestleMania." Cody goes, "I suppose you thought that was funny. I suppose you and Gunther and the rest of your little cronies are laughing about this. Well, I wouldn't be. Dustin tonight He didn't have to step up to Gunther. He did it because he's a badass. He's a champion. He's a Hall of Famer, and he will be back. But what you have just done is piss me off. Consider this an eye for an eye. And he just walks off. Angry Cody Rhodes. Huh? Okay. Rhea and Zoe Stark gets an 85. Like, Jesus fucking Christ. Rhea does win. Riptide in 952. 96 for Rhea Ripley, 56 for Zoe Stark. And somehow that equates to an 85. I'm not going to complain, but yeah. And then, yeah, big showing for Zoe, but she does unfortunately come up short against, you know, the former Women's World Champion. When after the match, Rhea continues the assault on Zoe. She locks her in that prison trap submission. And she's like, this is going to be you, Jade. This is going to be you, okay? This is going to be that bitch at WrestleMania. Well, now walks Tatum back to Lee. And Rhea sort of sees her climb into the ring, and then she drops Zoe. She's like, what the fuck is this? And Tatum walks up to Rhea. She, like, puts her hand on her shoulder. And she's like, me next. And Rhea's looking, like, so confused. She's like, what the fuck are you on about? Ivy Nile comes down. She's like, oh, sorry. Sorry about her. And Rhea's like, you again, okay? Did I not beat you a couple of weeks ago? She's like, yeah, but you took Tatum out a couple of weeks ago, and I don't know what's happened to her since. You know, I blame that fireball from Alba Fire, but sorry about this. And then she has to, like, sort of, like, push Tatum away as she's, like, trying to get Rhea Ripley, and Rhea's just there looking confused, like, what the fuck? What's this? And then get the House of Black. Aleister Black sat down in the chair, Ciampa and Brody King by each side. He's like, AJ, Finn, do you not feel guilty? Do you really think you're the heroes in your story? Because as an outsider looking in, all I can see is two people fighting a losing battle against evil. But instead of fighting a losing battle and dying nobly on their sword, what you've opted to do instead is when the lights are on brightest, on the biggest stage of them all, when the most eyes in the world will be on you, you've opted to bring a sacrifice. You've opted to drag a third wheel into this conflict. A person who has no interest in being dragged into this conflict. But you are selfish and you need the help to fight a battle that you cannot win. So AJ, Finn, I hope you can sleep at night. I hope you can look yourself in the mirror and see a man looking back at you and not a monster. Because we've always seen monsters looking back at us. So it's time to decide, boys. What do you truly want to be? Do you want to be mere men with a sacrifice who are going to fight a losing battle at WrestleMania? Or do you want to look deep into your soul, become those monsters, bring your third monster alongside you, and have a war? We then see a very downtrodden Saray, like, just sitting backstage. Or in the house, sorry, you know, because why would the Wrestling Academia boys be at the building? Why would they actually be wrestling? So she's at, like, an undisclosed location. Like a park bench or something. You can see all the anime boys training in the background. Sort of not taking notice of Saray, but Manny, of course, does. And he walks up to her. She's like, he's like, hey, you good? And he sort of looks up, you know, smeared makeup, like he's been crying. He's like, what's up? And she's like, she speaks in Japanese, because of course Manny, being a weeb, can understand Japanese, but, you know, it's subtitled so we can read it. And she's like, I caused all this. I brought the pendant into your life. And now, I've turned Sensei against us. we've got to fight. We're going to have to destroy the pendant. And Sensei. And potentially myself. And Manny goes, no, it's not your fault. I mean, you obviously had no idea that Sensei was going to act like this. It was inevitable, you know. Sensei had these tendencies inside them. This hungering for power that none of us knew about. An axiom. He can make the weight, and he's an evil genius, you see. Well, not evil genius, but he's a genius. He can use that genius for good or evil. He's using it for good in this situation to, you know, resolve a petty conflict between friends. I'm babbling. Why am I babbling? Well, anyway, what I'm saying is, Saray, look at my eyes. He sort of like holds her hands. Like, they glare at each other's eyes. And he goes, trust me. At WrestleMania, we're gonna take that championship from Sensei. We're gonna take that pendant from Sensei. Everything's gonna be okay. And after that, you and I can move on together. Well, not together, but like, we can both move on. And she sort of like laughs. It's like, thanks for comforting me. Because, hey, I couldn't sit here and see you sad. And then Dio calls back, goes, hey, Manny, you know, get over here, we need you. And he goes, the boys need me, I need to. And she's like, yeah, go. 80 rating. Kairi saying Aaliyah, cook here for some reason. Yeah, but Kairi does defeat Aaliyah in 10:15 with the insane elbow. Grayson Waller is out there, but he's unfortunately not enough to help his hot 10 girlfriend, as he'd call her, pick up a victory over Kairi. But yes, 67 for Aaliyah, 81 for Kairi. We then see Randy Orton walking through the hallway, Orange Cassidy just plodding behind him. Kathy Kelly walks up and goes, Randy, you know, why'd you come to the aid of Orange Cassidy tonight? And he's like, man, Kathy, you know, WrestleMania's coming up. I'm going to finally get a chance to put Christian's right hand of justice, as he called him. I call him his little bitch boy, Dijak. Get to finally put him in his place and take his championship title so him and Christian can stop walking around here thinking they're champions. But there's a lot of people in that match, Kathy Kelly. It's not just Dijak, who's an asshole and he's his head kicked in, okay? Because Dirty Dom, you know, I've known his dad for a long, long time. Me and his dad used to hate each other. Now I've got a ton of respect for his father. I love Ray. And his best friend, that goof, Grayson Waller, they both need their heads kicked in next week. So next week it'll be Randy Orton against Dominic Mysterio and Grayson Waller. And he sort of turns around to Orange Cassidy, he goes, I guess this guy's going to be my partner. He's like, Orange, do you want to be Randy Orton's partner next week against Grayson Waller and Dominic Mysterio? I don't like Dom. Dominic's an asshole. I'll be your partner. Sure. I guess. And he sort of walks off and he goes, well, Kathy, I can't tell if he's enthused or not. I haven't really got to know this guy just yet. He seems cool, but next week he's my friend. But at WrestleMania, he's also another op of Randy Orton. He's one of seven men who's going to taste the three most destructive letters in WWE. R-K-O. We then cut to Gorilla. Kathy Kelly's getting her job, her money's worth tonight. We cut from the Bulge Badges in the Randy Orton segment, and then leads to ads. And then we come back and she's in Gorilla with R-Truth instead. He's like, R-Truth, tonight it appears you're going out alone against Pretty Deadly. Have you not managed to find a replacement partner after Rollins got attacked last week? And he goes, Kathy Kelly, I told you I've been looking. I've been searching up and down for my tag team partner. Hell, I reached out to my childhood hero, John Cena. Okay, because I hear he does a lot of make-a-wish. I hope he was going to make my childhood wish come true tonight and be my tag team partner against the Rockers. And then we can go to SummerSlam to wrestle for the tag team titles. But I guess he's busy in Los Angeles or something, Kathy. So unfortunately, he's not going to make it here tonight. And Kathy sort of looks confused. He goes, Truth, we're in Los Angeles tonight. And he's like, Kathy, are you crazy? Have you been drinking? We're in Las Vegas tonight. Not Los Angeles, Kathy. That's a big difference. She goes, no, this is the Staples Center. We're in Los Angeles, California. He went, no, when I came in, the airport, it said, LAX. Okay. And that's kind of like Las Vegas. She's like, no, LAX. That's LA, you're in Los Angeles. He's like, oh, well, I guess I'm on for a Hollywood story here tonight, Kathy Kelly. There's no one here to help me. I'm a channel my childhood hero, John Cena, beat two men at once and go to WrestleMania by myself.
And he goes out to the match. A 72 rated match for a lot of different reasons.
Mainly the booking. But yeah, pretty deadly against R-Truth. R-Truth, he comes out, you know, he's fired up. You know, he's looking to channel his inner John Cena. He hits the shoulder charges on Pretty Deadly. He hits the five moves of doom. He goes for the yay yay, but the other member of Pretty Deadly like chops his leg from behind. And then Pretty Deadly are on the offense. You know, they're just beating up R-Truth for an extended period of time. He goes to like make a hot tag. He probably does the jump for the hot tag, but there's nobody in the corner. And, you know, it looks like Truth's about to be beaten. They're picking him up, ready to hit him with spilled milk. When John Cena's music hits. And, you know, Pre-Dev, you're looking confused. Like, oh, come on, you know. Ah, ha, ha, I get it. Very funny, okay. But look, True, if you've got nobody. But alas, Big Match John is here. He is busy in Los Angeles, but I guess he's made time. He storms down to the ring. He throws his shirt into the crowd. He stands on the apron. He offers his arm out to Truth. Truth looks around like he's grinning from ear to ear, gleefully enjoy. Makes the hot tag to John Cena. John Cena then hits the five moves of doom on Kit Wilson. Hits the AA. And he pins Kit Wilson. Huh. John Cena had limited involvement, so again he gets a 65. 61 for R-Truth, 71 for Ellen Prince, 70 for Kit. But this match stipulation was that the winning team would go to WrestleMania to wrestle for the Raw Tag Team titles. And, I mean, you can see it with your own two eyes. The winning team here tonight was John Cena and R-Truth.
We then cut back, go to ads after that, cut back, Kathy Kelly catches up with John Cena.
It's like, John, you know, what a surprise, you know, showing up to Raw unannounced, you know, what brought you here? And he goes, Kathy, when I heard Raw was in LA, and I was like, hey, I'm in LA. Why can't I make this surprise stop and surprise the WWE Universe here tonight? But it's more important than that, Kathy Kelly. I got a text from my old friend, R-Truth. He said something about me being his childhood hero, but I thought I was older than him, and he must have, you know, forgotten a few years ago and forgiven me, but hey, a lot of people have. I thought I'd stop by and I'd help him win. It's like, oh my god, John Cena. You're like my idol, man. Thanks for coming to my help. He goes, Truth, we've met. In fact, last time we were together, I beat your ass. And he goes, you did? Well, I forgive you, my hero, John Cena. Anyway, I hope your movie schedule ain't free for April 7th because we're going to SummerSlam. And Cena turns around to Kathy Kelly, he's like, SummerSlam in the spring? How long have I been gone? It's like, he means WrestleMania. You're going to WrestleMania with R-Truth because you beat Pretty Deadly tonight. And he goes, I am? Oh my, Kathy, this is news to me. I'll make sure my schedule's clear. I've got a lot of stuff to get out of my way, but I will be there. I will be at WrestleMania, and I will team with R-Truth to face Logan Paul and KSI for the Raw Tag Team Championships. And then he walks off, and then R-Truth's sitting there just like giggling for joy, going, that's my childhood hero, John Cena, Kathy Kelly. She's like, yeah, you've said a lot, actually. Next week, we have one match set for next week. And that match will be that aforementioned tag team match where Randy Orton teams with Orange Cassidy, RKO Jay, to take on Grayson Waller and Dirty Dom, the obnoxious best friends, with their collective hot girlfriends, but one of them's not really a girlfriend. But anyway, it's a whole thing. But yeah, that match will go down next week on Raw. And we've got two new announcements for WrestleMania tonight. The first being another grudge match between Drew McIntyre and Xavier Woods. Will WrestleMania in Philadelphia be Woods' underdog story? Will he finally prove that he can hang at the top, that he can defeat Drew McIntyre? Or will Drew McIntyre prove us himself right and once again extinguish Xavier Woods' fire? And also, I guess this is now official, at WrestleMania, the partners in prime, Logan Paul and KSI, team up to defend the Raw Tag Team Championships against R-Truth and John Cena. 86. Speaking of WrestleMania implications, this match right here has a ton. Becky and Charlotte, Sasha and Bayley, two teams who can't stand each other, but also can't stand their respective tag team partners. So it's basically a competition of who can coexist the most, because we know this is going to break down. You know, this aggressive tag, Sasha slapping Bayley like as she tags out and shit like that. Charlotte like tagging Becky in as she's getting her ass beat and like patting her on the head going, go on, get in the match. But as Charlotte alluded to earlier on tonight, Sasha and Bayley have been a team for, you know, a lot longer. They teamed up like not 2 months ago to try and challenge for the tag titles, which ended with Sasha turning on Bayley. But I digress. So it's more in the court of Becky and Charlotte that have to, you know, find it within themselves to put their egos aside and work together to prevent this impending fatal four-way if they carry on bickering. And Becky, she's doing a good job at that. Until, you know, there's like a miscommunication, Charlotte accidentally clocks Becky and she like forearms Charlotte in the face. Charlotte falls to the floor. And she goes to get back on the apron and she's like, you know what? Have fun, you know. If you think you're running this division, you can beat everybody. You can beat 1, 2, 3 opponents. Try beating 2 at once. And then Charlotte just walks to the back. And Becky's like, well, fuck. And in the end, Bayley pins the WWE Women's Champion with a rose plant in 20 minutes 28. So, all that talk about her being the weak link, you know, she was a champion coming out of WrestleMania, or going into WrestleMania's main event last year, but that was still the longest time ago that any of these women held the women's title. But she does pin the women's champion tonight, meaning for, well, the first time in main roster history, for the second time ever. In fact, nearly 10 years, just over 10 years since the last encounter. Or was that in 2015? That was definitely in 2015. Okay. So, just under 10 years since the last time, the Four Horsewomen will do battle in a fatal four-way match for the WWE Women's Championship at WrestleMania. Potentially in one of the main events, but I am going to address the main event situation after this episode goes up. So, you know, not necessarily the main event, but it could very much well be the main event of one of the nights. Then after the match, Bayley celebrating, she's immediately jumped by Sasha Banks. Sasha leaves her laying with a backstabber, you know, that bank statement finisher, whatever it's called, the new one, the pinfall move. And then, of course, she grabs the belt from ringside. She stands tall over Becky and Bayley, both down, holding the belt up high, pointing at WrestleMania, because she's going to WrestleMania. Bayley got her there. But she's given it the big 'un. 92 overall raid show. That's pretty good. A lot of drama on tonight's show. A lot of big segments, you know. The Cody stuff was a big development. You know, John Cena's here. And he's teaming with R-Truth at WrestleMania. But yeah. The formation of the new greatest tag team, RKOJ. But yes, it's now time to see you on the other side for Heat. Heat kicks off with Brandi Rhodes in her office again, you know, running down tonight's card. You know, Sonya Deville is going to take on NXT's Coral Justice. As well as tonight, Tiffany Stratton will take on Marika of JFlow. And then Chelsea Green walks in and says, Brandi, A word, please. This is unacceptable behavior. Okay, I'm the queen of extreme, and this is Heat, the all-woman show. Okay, and my hubby, Matt Cardona, you know, he's got a worker guy at WrestleMania who loves Heat. So I thought I would show up on this show, and I demand you, my manager on this show, put me in a match tonight. And Zelina Vega walks in. She's like, oh, all you do is complain. You know, I was off training, okay, because my boys have got an important battle at WrestleMania because, you know, they've got to try and, you know, I don't know, save the frickin' world while you're having some petty debate about who's extreme and who's not. The answer is not you, Chelsea. It's like, are you hearing the way that she's talking to me, Brandy? I think you should fine her. It's like, oh, I am actually going to do something with Zelina tonight, but it's not going to be fining her, Chelsea. It's going to be giving her a match in the main event against you. It's like, oh, you finally give me what I want, Brandy, but you still managed to piss me off. Grr! And she, like, scoots out of the room. But yeah, there's a match made later on tonight, Chelsea Green against Zelina Vega. Our opening match is the aforementioned match, Tony Deville against Coral Justice from NXT. Sonya does win in 7:59. 74 for Sonya, 42 for Coral. So yeah, 68 for that, it's actually that bad. And after the match, Sonya takes a mic, and she's like, Shayna Baszler. Okay, I don't know what your deal is with me, but I like the sound of it. Okay, I've been looking for a challenger like you for a long, long time, and you came to me last week, and you really sent a message that you're somebody that I need to be stepping into this ring with. Out comes Shayna and Carmella. She goes, Sonya, I think it's better to sit here and explain myself because, you know, it's a little bit out of nowhere that I came and attacked you last week. But I have my reasons, Sonya. You see, you, my friend, seem to think that you're some sort of badass here in the women's division because you're, what, a former Raw Women's Champion, a former SmackDown Women's Champion. Yeah, a Raw Women's title that you held for a day. Okay, I was a Raw Women's Champion for 4 months. Because I'm actually a badass, I'm actually tough, and I'm not a wannabe tough girl. Because you accepted mediocrity, and you accepted falling into obscurity on a third brand. Whereas me, when I wasn't getting what I wanted, I left. I went down to Mexico, me and Carmella, we formed a bond down there, and I've come back even tougher than you'll ever be. So there's no need for someone like you around here now, Sonya, because we have me. Now sit back and watch us. Me and Mella show you how it's really done. And then they have a tag team match against Shotzi and Scarlett, which gets us a 78. That's actually pretty good. Yeah, they defeat... Shayna defeats Scarlett with a Kirifuda clutch in 12:56. 80 for Shayna, 61 for Carmella, 72 for Shotzi, 66 for Scarlett. We then get a backstage interview with Alicia Sanford. She's like, my guest, Tiffany Stratton. Tiffany's all stressed out. And she's like, Tiffany, she's like, enough, Alicia, okay, toodles, I'm here on Tiffy time, okay, my Tiffy time is very, very, very scarce, and I got a big win over Kyrie, and I'm on top of my Tiffy world, but now I hear that Brandy's got me working, you know, the fifth wheel of J-Flow on a Monday night. She's lucky I even showed up here, because this isn't acceptable. I'd refuse to work this match. Then Mariah May walks like, hey, Tiffy, I'm back. It's like, oh my god, Mariah, you're back. I'm so happy to see you. You know, it's been a rough couple of months without having you by my side. Anyway, it's really glad you're here, because guess what I just heard? She's like, what? She goes, Brandy just told me that you are in a match tonight with my Marika of J-Flow. She's like, well, this is the first I've heard of this. I didn't even know Brandy knew I was cleared. It's like, yeah, well, you gotta go get your gear on. She went, I didn't bring my gear, Tiffany. Just, oh, you'll have to borrow some of mine, silly. Now, run along. Of course, it won't look anywhere near as good as you as it does on me, but, you know, you pick out my gear a lot. You're good at this kind of stuff. You know, go, come on, get ready. Shoo. So, yeah, I guess Mariah May will be subbing in for Tiffany Stratton in the matchup next. 59. I guess that's all right, considering Mariah May is not very popular. But, of course, Mariah May wasn't prepared for this. Is wrestling in Tiffany Stratton's gear. She does get defeated by Marika in 10:16 of machine gun drop. Marika gets a 64, 37 for Mariah. Then, our main event gets a 69. Zelina Vega defeats Chelsea Green with a moonsault in 10:58. 69 for Zelina, 48 for Chelsea. And that ends a pretty fun episode of Heat. You know, there's some segments on here that I liked. and every match sort of had a reason to exist. But yeah, 72. What matters more than what you thought of the show, mainly of Raw. And yeah, I'll see you next time for episode 497, where we will see the God in action. And also Jey Uso, who came back on the show, but more importantly, the God. See you then.